Well, good morning. Can I welcome everyone to this, the 15th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item for the committee to consider is whether or not to take agenda items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private today. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. The principal item on this morning's agenda is for us to give consideration to an important report which the Auditor General published in April of this year, which relates to audit work conducted up until March of this year, so very up-to-date in its both data and analysis. And it's a report into how the Scottish Government is set to deliver climate change goals. And can I welcome our witnesses to the committee this morning? First of all, Stephen Boyle, Auditor General, you're very welcome. Alongside the Auditor General this morning is Rebecca Seidel, who's a senior manager at Audit Scotland, and also Sally Thompson, who's also a senior manager at Audit Scotland. As usual, we've got quite a wide range of questions to put to you this morning. But before we get into those questions, Auditor General, can I ask you to give us an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Convener, today I'm bringing the Committee my report that looks at how the Scottish Government is set up to drive delivery of its national net zero targets and adaptation outcomes. Climate change is the defining issue of our time, and the Scottish Government has set ambitious goals for tackling it. This is a complex policy area, with the causes and consequences of climate change sitting across a range of ministerial portfolios and Scottish Government directorates. My report focuses on governance and risk management arrangements, which are always important, but particularly so in the context of a complex area that cuts across many areas of government and where progress needs to be made quickly. Effective arrangements can help to support policy and financial decision making and identify risks to delivering actions on time and on budget. They also provide transparency and make sure different parts of government can be held to account for their progress. Governance and risk management arrangements for climate change have improved since 2019, reflecting its increased priority. Nonetheless, my report also highlights that there are some weaknesses and gaps. Arrangements need to be strengthened to support the Scottish Government to deliver on its climate change ambitions. The report outlines several recommendations to help do this. These include improving how key groups align with each other and coordinate their actions, making sure effective reporting arrangements are in place to ensure progress is delivered, and introducing more systematic processes to identify and manage the key risks to achieving climate change goals. Addressing climate change will be a challenge for all of us. The Scottish Government will be better placed to meet its goals by improving its own governance and risk management of climate change. Convener, Sally, Rebecca and I will do our utmost as ever to answer the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm sure that we will return through the next hour or so to some of those questions about where there are gaps, where there is a lack of clarity, and how things are working. I want to begin with a question on governance arrangements. And we're really interested to understand from the work that you've done your sense of the extent to which there is cross-government collaboration taking place in order to progress both the climate change actions and also the management of competing priorities, because we do take evidence on issues like government expenditure on major capital projects, and we are now beginning to interrogate more the extent to which they contribute positively or maybe even negatively towards those net zero goals. So I wonder whether you could address that question of cross-governmental collaboration.
Yeah, many thanks, Convener. I'll start actually, and I'll bring Sally in. Sally's going to support much of the governance-related questions this morning, and Rebecca will lead on some of the risk management discussions. The first thing I would say, to an extent, is the answer to your question, Convener, and of course elaborate upon that. It's undoubtedly complex, the governance arrangements to support what's equally a very complex area of delivery that has many interdependencies across government in terms of what may be potentially competing areas of policy and those that are aligned. We set out in the report this morning, I suppose, some of that complexity of governance arrangements, just with the scale and breadth of arrangements. You mentioned in your introductory remarks, convener, some of the ministerial arrangements, which we know have changed since our reporting was made. And then also would identify in terms of some of the official level governance arrangements. We do have now a dedicated Director General for Net Zero, which is welcome, that post holder now permanently in post following a period of interim arrangements. So there's some progress. We see also at the executive team level within the Scottish Government a clarity of additional focus through, you know, dashboard emphasis on some of the decision making on climate change. So that oversight, but progress hasn't been consistent with what we would describe as the former First Minister setting the climate emergency. So there are some misalignment, we would say, and I think that's kind of the overall conclusion of our report today, that to deliver upon climate change ambitions, 75% reduction to net zero targets by the end of this decade, and then the legally binding targets by 2045, there needs to be action taken both on governance and risk management to ensure that that collaboration takes place. I'll hand over to Sally in a second, convener, but one kind of last thing I would say is the report also references some of the research that was done, case study one, that the government and the parliament undertook about some of the changes that need to take place. And ultimately, and I know this remains key focus for the Public Audit Committee, that what spending is planned, how is that set out clearly about the impact that public spending will have through the budget to meet climate change ambitions? That also needs to be much more clearly set out for the Parliament's own scrutiny of budget setting arrangements. So some gaps, some collaboration happening, but much work still to undertake, convener. Again, I'll stop, and Sally can come in on any of those points as she wishes.
Thank you. So yes, as the Auditor General said, I think a lot of the governance groups that have been created for climate change, so the Global Climate Emergency Programme Board and the Deputy Directors Network and the Policy Delivery Boards, they're all around ensuring cross-government working and collaboration. But what we found is there's a lack of links between these bodies. So we don't see, there's no reporting from the Deputy Director Network. So the Deputy Director Network and the policy boards were set up to allow the Global Emergency Programme Board to provide assurance in that collaborative cross-government working. But there's no direct links between those bodies. They're a bit infrequent, or they're not as they set out in their terms of reference. So I think there is an understanding and a desire within the Scottish Government to have this collaborative working, but the systems are not in place that clearly support it, so it's difficult to get that assurance. I think in terms of your points about the budgets, as the Auditor General said, the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament did commission work on trying to assess the impact of carbon impact of budgets and of spending, and this is a complicated area, and it is an area that the government is working and trying to improve. But I would say that the Scottish Government acknowledge that things are not perfect and are aware of the gaps and where they need to try and work to fill them.
Yeah, I mean, I think there is a sense which I'd picked up from the report which you did, but also from the recommendations coming out of the Scottish Government's own Just Transition Commission, that there is a degree of impatience that the climate emergency was declared back in 2019 and in 2023. Some of these fairly basic building blocks are still not in place in a way that we would perhaps expect. One of the things that struck me in this really picks up on Sally Thompson's comments there. One of the things that struck me was the comments around Exhibit 3 in the report, where you refer to what you describe as exception reporting being in place between key government groups. In other words, there is no routine, systematic or regular collaboration in that sense. It's almost as though It will only happen not quite by chance, but it won't routinely happen. I mean, do you have any comments on that?
There's certainly a reliance on the same individuals being within the same groups. So the chair of the deputy director network is linked in, sits on the programme board. The DG Net Zero himself then links into all the corporate structure. So there's a lot of reliance on individuals rather than on reports and sort of systematic structures. And I think one of the risks that we highlight is that staff change, knowledge changes, so there can be a loss of you know, there's no clear roles and accountabilities. So different staff in the Scottish Government's understanding was different. So the Scottish Government's own governance model that they created in 2021 has not been updated. So we've created this based on our understanding of how things work, the terms of reference, discussions with the Scottish Government. And that was something that an internal audit report recommended should be done last year. The Scottish Government, you know, accepted that and set a time to do it, and it still hasn't been done. I think issues that the Scottish Government would say is it's around about capacity issues quite often.
OK, but obviously as a parliamentary committee with an interest in this area, part of our role is to hold government to account, and it might be that we will consider what you've just told us, Sally Thompson, as something that we might want to take up. One of the other things that struck me about it was on the question of transparency. I mean, does the GCE, the programme board, publish minutes, for example? Does it have minutes? Does it publish them? Are they in the public domain?
It has minutes, but I do not believe they're in the public domain. No, I think we got them through the Scottish Government.
OK. Auditor General?
Thanks, Convener. I think that point of transparency, I think, again, looking at Exhibit 3, there's a lot going on in terms of the different groups across government who have an interest in climate change. To some extent, that's not surprising, given, as you allude to, that climate change is going to require a concerted effort really across all policy areas, and that understanding and the point of exception reporting is very important, as is the escalation arrangements, that ultimately there is effective oversight happens, and that oversight also needs to be transparent so that government, you know, can clearly map out themselves. I think Sally mentioned that this is our exhibit, you know, we've pulled this together, so perhaps illustrates in a small point just about the need for government itself to be clearer on how all its groups interact, and that they're clear about which elements are informal, which elements require formal public engagement, and then how they'll best report that. So I think that there just needs to be that next step, convener, that sets out clearly for the Parliament and the public about how accountability best operates on climate change matters.
Thanks. And on a similar theme, you draw attention in the report to the Deputy Director Network, which you describe in the report as a key climate change governance body, but it seems to operate informally. And again, ask the basic question, do they produce minutes?
No, they do not produce minutes, so there's okay. There's no paperwork. So it was described to us during our audit as the engine room, where a lot of the sort of real delivery happens, but there's no minutes of the meetings.
Yes, yes. Well, I guess my maybe it's just my experience of these things is it would be useful to understand whether it's an engine room or a talking shop.
Quite convenient, I think. And I think I'm careful in making any kind of blanket assumption that every single group has to be have that level of formality, minute taken. You know, there rightfully will be times that, you know, officials and public body can convene together to share ideas and so forth. But there seems to be a contradiction here with deputy director group. I mean, these are senior civil servants, you know, that will have responsibilities across government to assess how climate change is impacting on their policy leads. The audit's judgment on it, well, there ought to be some formality, especially if, you know, using the phrase of the engine room. and its connections into the Global Climate Emergency Programme Board and the flow through from that, all of that, we think, just requires an additional level of formality. Minute taking is one of those fundamentals.
Thank you. That's helpful to get that on the record. I'm now going to excuse me, invite the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to put some questions to you. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. The report states that the most recent climate change governance map reflects the arrangements as at June 2021, despite significant changes to both corporate and climate change governance having taken place since then. The report then goes on to state that frequent changes to complex cross-cutting governance arrangements and the lack of clear documentation makes it difficult for teams across the Scottish Government to see where responsibilities lie and could hinder collaborative working on this cross-cutting priority area. Do you have any examples of where collaborative working has been hindered?
I'll maybe start actually and I'll bring Sally in a moment. And I think the first thing I would recognise, Deputy Convener, is that there are some mitigations here. Clearly, you know, that there was a global pandemic that took place over these, you know, early years. So recognising that that will have, you know, diverted focus and attention away from some of the governance arrangements and some of the progress that may have impeded collaboration. If one example, I'll maybe refer to both positive and with more work to do, and Sally may wish to elaborate upon that or choose a different example. It's welcome that the Scottish Exchequer Directorate is playing a more active role on climate change matters. And we set some of that out in the report, given their responsibilities in terms of collating both tax policy arrangements and budget setting arrangements for the Scottish budget. Case study one, though, highlights that there's more work to do around this area, based on the research commissioned for the Parliament and the Government in terms of carbon assessments. Inevitably, there'll be really difficult choices. I think that the Government, public bodies as a whole, and us as individuals will have to make over the course of the next decade about, you know, how we heat our homes, how we travel, the food we eat. All of these choices will come our way. But they'll be better informed by having that collaboration that's very effective, clearly set out within government, so that we're making those decisions in a transparent, careful way. And that's what really the emphasis of today's report, having those fundamentals of how the setup in terms of governance and risk management, getting these right will make some of these decisions clearer and fairer and evidence-based into the future. Sally may wish to elaborate on the role of Scottish Exchequer or other factors that, as she wishes.
Certainly, when the DG Net Zero got put in post, he looked to refresh the programme board and has tried to work to, I think, to improve the sort of collaborative work there, and has included DG Exchequer there, and they've obviously commissioned the work trying to assess the impact of spend. But a lot of the work happens within policy boards and at directorate level, and we just can't see how these link in. So we can't see how these things are connected.
Okay, thanks. The report states that a workforce plan for the DG Net Zero area was expected in spring 2023. So we're nearly halfway through May now. Is that timescale likely to be met?
So we've not had any update positively confirmed from the DG Net Zero Directorate since publication that a workforce plan has now been produced. We'll continue to track that, Deputy Convener, but it may be something that the Directorate can confirm directly to the committee.
Okay, thanks. The report refers to workforce capacity and capabilities being key challenges identified by the Scottish Government. Can you tell us more about the key challenges, what the key challenges are, and what steps the Scottish Government is taking to address them?
Yeah, certainly. I'll bring Sally in again to say a bit more about that. I think really the dedicated leadership, kind of say first of all, of DG Net Zero felt like an important step for the civil service to say here is the leadership and our intention around capacity to deliver climate change goals, responsibilities across government. It's clear that DG Net Zero is not going to deliver climate change ambitions on their own. So they need to have that understanding both through their own workforce plan, because you know, this was a migration of resources from other directorates that people existed into a new directorate within government, bringing in skills and capacity from there, but mapping forward, as it were, over the course of the 2020s to the 75% target and then into 2045, that's going to require a short, medium and long-term workforce plan, a skills matrix that identifies what skills and capacity does the Scottish Government need to deliver upon its climate change ambitions. And this will also require difficult choices, because at the same time, the Scottish Government has already committed by 2026-27 to return civil service numbers to what they were pre-Brexit, allowing for the increase in resources that took place to support Brexit discussions and then COVID size. So complex areas to be mapped and navigated through, Deputy Convener, in terms of there is a workforce plan that can deliver upon climate change ambitions. What the government publishes imminently, spring 2023, for DG Net Zero, will be really pivotal. Apologies, we'll pass to Sally in a second, but I think it's also a continuation of some audit recommendations upon for the Scottish Government. We mentioned it in the Section 22 report on the Scottish Government at the end of last year, that real need for clear, transparent, comprehensive workforce strategy to support all of these competing ambitions. So much work to be done on this front. Again, I'll pause and pass to Sally.
Hi, thank you. So yes, the issue around about sort of capacity within the Scottish Government to deliver on climate change was raised at various interviews and is often given to us as a reason for things not happening. I mentioned the governance map hasn't been updated because of capacity. There are other things. So often the terms of reference suggest that people make recommendations to different groups and we have no evidence of that. The issues around about capacity were, I think, particularly referenced around about adaptation, where we can see that there's a lot less focus in terms of how we adapt to the impacts of climate change that we're already facing. So these have been stated by the Scottish Government in papers and in interviews as reasons for a lack of progress, if you like. When we were doing the audit, there was a recruitment freeze within the SG, but I think that's been lifted. And just towards the end of the audit, a programme manager has been brought in to work on the GCE programme board, and I think the hope and the expectation is that they'll be able to bring a lot of this sort of structure and rigour that is lacking.
Okay, thank you. And last, your report states that governance arrangements to help Scotland adapt to the impact of climate change are less developed than those for reducing emissions. Do you know why this situation has occurred?
We can certainly kind of build on a little bit further in terms of the report, and Sally can equally say more. It may be for government to give their perspective on why there's a difference between a very clear and focus on climate emissions reductions relative to adaptations. And I think that's the evidence that we've seen, that a real, you know, even in terms of Rebecca may wish to say a bit more about how that's manifested itself in some of the risk management arrangements. Know, clear evidence that carbon emissions has been high profile risk for government in its corporate risk arrangements going back to the end of the previous decade, adaptations less so. And I think even some of the news over the past few days that global temperatures are going to increase beyond the ambition of 1.5 degrees Celsius by 2027, that's inevitably going to bring changes to climate that we'll have to adapt our lives to. We're already seeing that in terms of some of flooding arrangements, more severe, unpredictable storms that are going to require changes in how we live our life, but also public investment beyond what we're already committing to in terms of flood defences and so forth. And that requires comprehensive and governance and risk management arrangements that bring parity to work on adaptations and climate emission reductions. Both have to go hand in hand, but we haven't seen that yet, Deputy Convener. Again, I'll pass to Rebecca and indeed Sally if they wish to say anything further.
Thanks, Auditor General. So we found that adaptation wasn't given as much priority within the risk management arrangements in the Scottish Government. So the failure to to adapt to the impacts of climate change is given a lower risk score than the failure to meet net zero targets. And that's in large part because some of these impacts won't be felt until the much longer term, but the reality is that action to address them needs to be happening now. So because they don't feature as such a high risk score within risk registers, there's then that risk that they're not considered as much within executive level decision making, and so the potential for them not to be treated as urgently as perhaps the risk of not meeting the net zero targets. So we saw that coming through in the risk registers, and also saw that adaptation in other areas just wasn't given as much focus. So for example, it wasn't added as a formal work stream to the Global Climate Emergency Programme Board until a couple of years after that board had been established. And also there's not currently a performance management dashboard for adaptation as there is for emissions reductions, but that is something that we know the Scottish Government are currently working on. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. We're now going to move on to another area that's highlighted in the report, which Willie Coffey has got some questions about. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. Stephen, I wonder if we could talk a little bit more about spending impacts. We've touched on it a few times in the conversation so far, and just to get a sense from you about how you see this panning out. Are you saying that the government needs to be clearer about its spending targets to achieve the net zero targets or so on? And I think you just said a moment ago that because of the climate change taking place, it's going to mean that we'll have to spend additional money in things like flooding, flood prevention. So could you just give us a little perspective on how you see the spending situation and that looking forward to how we tackle these issues?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Coffey. Very happy to do that. Before referencing what the conclusions in this report, I think it's maybe worth just referring again to publication that I know the committee's heard a fair amount on over the past few weeks, which was the Scottish Fiscal Commission's report that looked towards 2050. So some alignment with the targets to deliver net zero by 2045. And their judgment were that if there weren't changes or reforms, particularly focusing on health and social care, that that would consume a considerably part of the Scottish budget to the detriment of other policy areas. And really looking at some of the shorter term implications, you mentioned case study one already, that there is a lack of alignment, work going on, but a lack of alignment so far on some of the carbon assessments alongside the Scottish budget. These are the type of clarity that we'll need to see, that decision makers, lawmakers in the Parliament we'll need to see for making budget choices, that it's clear what public spending is contributing to managing the implications of climate change. And that might mean that difficult choices and prioritisations, more money on adaptation, such as flood defences that you mentioned, and expect to see really an alignment with the national outcomes, the national performance framework and the Scottish budget. So we'd say that there's absolutely work being undertaken, Mr. Coffey. There's a recognition of the need to move towards this direction, but it's that level of clarity of decision making that we'll need to see and expect that that will come to fruition for the 24-25 budget cycle.
So it's both clarity and perhaps shifting balance and shifting emphasis that we have to face up to, really, in budgeting.
I mean, I think I would agree. I mean, if you're looking at the legally binding obligations that are set out for Scotland to deliver upon net zero by 2045, 5 years ahead of other parts of the UK. And to deliver upon that will require focus in terms of high quality governance and risk management arrangements, clarity and transparency of what public spending will deliver in terms of carbon assessments and adaptations. And these are the steps and choices that we'll all have to make over the course of the next few years.
Mm-hmm. You're saying in the report as well, there's no routine assessment taking place of the impact of the policies and spend on emissions. Is that something we need to really get a grip of so that we can demonstrate that one leads to the other?
Yeah, I'll bring Sally in and say a bit more about this. And perhaps as I said a couple of times, there's undoubtedly work happening. You know, 2024 will see the Scottish Government publish its next climate change plan. That also feels like an important milestone, along with the budget process, to give that clarity about what's going to happen, what spending is going to take place, and what the anticipated impact of that spending will be. Sally can say more.
Yes, thank you. Yes, the next climate change plan, as the Auditor General says, is due. The draft is due at the end of this year, finalised the beginning of next year, and there's a legal requirement that that is going to be funded. It's got to currently be costed, because currently it's uncosted. So going forward, there are going to have to be costs in there. The Scottish Government themselves recognise the need for sort of multi-year ongoing funding for climate change. And as Stephen said, there's work ongoing with the DG Exchequer to try and facilitate that. In terms of the carbon impact, they are also looking to improve how they do that in the case study one, the work that the Fraser Valander and Climate Exchange did, is sort of a building blocks to that, but it's not something that's easy to get right. But I think there is a commitment from the Scottish Government to consider the carbon impact on significant policies at an early stage going forward, but the timescales for that are still not clear.
Okay, you've kind of covered a couple of areas I was going to touch on there, but thank you for that. Just in terms of the climate change plan update, you also say that we need to be a bit clearer about what policies are actually in that, what policies will appear in that. What do we need to do to make that abundantly clearer?
So a lot of this, the Climate Change Committee are the expert independent body that looks at the climate change plans and the targets. So they have recommended for the last few years that the Scottish Government really needs to be clearer about what its policies are and how they are going to impact on targets and outcomes. There's currently, the CCC believe, quite a disconnect between the policies that we have and the emission reduction pathways that are in the plan. So we need to make sure that we're much clearer about how they come together. What that look like in the forthcoming plan, we don't know. But yeah, that's the intention.
I'm glad you mentioned the Climate Change Committee. We had Chris Stark, who gave evidence to our Housing Local Government Committee just a couple of weeks ago, and his message initially was pretty positive. And he basically started the discussion convener telling us that we've basically achieved the decarbonisation of the power system in Scotland. We've basically done that. But the big ticket items that still remain, and you mentioned a few of them yourself, Stephen, are the impact on our buildings and homes. That's a huge issue. Transport, and he mentioned industry and agriculture. These are the big issues that are perhaps in the second half of the marathon that we're engaged in, and they'll be the most difficult to deliver. Do you recognise that and accept that these are the biggest challenges we still face?
Yeah, we absolutely do recognise that, Mr Coffey. And, you know, looking at the CCC's report from December, those are three areas that they set out that will require that real focus, decisions, tough choices, perhaps, over the course of the rest of this decade. I mean, certainly, drawing on the work of Chris Stark and his team, setting out conclusions that Scotland was ahead but has slipped behind in the past few years and has got work to do to meet its targets from the 2009 Scottish Climate Change Act. This will remain a real area of audit focus for us, alongside the science climate change experts at CCC. How we heat our homes is a piece of audit work that we're giving consideration to as well, and can brief the committee further on that in due course. There needs to be that both effective scrutiny, transparency from policymakers, and then also that real clarity about what the impact of some of these choices will make to support the prioritisation, Mr Coffey.
He talked about having quantified delivery plans. That was quite a common theme throughout what he was saying. Is that something you recognise? Are we short of doing that kind of thing in a whole range of policy areas, just quantifying what we want to achieve? And take for example, the target to reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030. I mean, it doesn't take a genius to work out that we need to drop it by about 3% for the next 7 years to get there. I mean, is that the kind of thing that we're talking about, to quantify this and to be able to report that we've achieved it or not?
Absolutely. You know, you would expect me as an auditor to say that, you know, you're going to have to draw on quantifiable evidence to make an assessment of progress. You know, whether it's car kilometres or tree planting, you know, so we have statistics and evidence available. There is work underway. So tree planting, the Scottish Government tells us that they're currently planting 16,000 hectares of trees per annum against their own target of 20,000, and the CCC recommending you need to be up at 45,000. So I think we know what the base is, but it's say, well, and how are you going to get to that level that will deliver upon climate change reductions is the next step. So absolutely, that has to be supported by quantifiable targets and also costed and funded at the same time, as Sally rightly mentions.
And are you broadly satisfied or otherwise that we are focused sufficiently on this quantification process right across the portfolio areas?
I think we're satisfied that, you know, people know what needs to happen in terms of a budget that's aligned with outcomes for across the national performance framework, as we've spoken about many times, but also the carbon assessment implication of that, that the various next steps in terms of meeting 2030 interim targets and then to 2045 has medium and long-term plans that set out very clearly what steps are going to be taken that can be measured for scrutiny purposes, absolutely, but also very likely that, you know, the book, a plan covering as many years as that will need to flex and change at various points to allow for circumstances and external events. But having that, but being able to make those choices over the course of the next few years requires a clear baseline of where we are currently. And that's the work that we see for the climate change plan for 2024 and then the budget for 2024-25. These are such important next steps, Mr. Coffey.
OK, that's great. Thanks very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I mean, sometimes as a committee, we consider elements of public life which are almost unique, the National Health Service, for example. But the global climate emergency is something which every government in both the North and Southern Hemisphere are having to face up to. So I guess when you say in the report, and just to reiterate what I said at the start, this is a report which came out just last month based on audit work carried out up until March of this year. At that point, you are still saying the Scottish Government does not routinely carry out carbon assessments or capture the impact of spending decisions on its carbon footprint in the long term. I mean, is that because they don't have the template to use? Presumably other governments are grappling with these kind of measures and impact assessments and so on. Is there any good reason, learning from international experience, why these things couldn't be brought in and become an integral part of decision making in the Scottish Government?
I'll bring Sally in to say a bit more about our discussions with government in this area, convener. I think the first thing I would say is that I think the government recognise that this is a gap that they need to address quite quickly and have set out their intention to do this in the updated climate change plan. Our view is that, you know, for many years there hasn't been a clear enough alignment between spending plans and outcomes from spending plans, you know, both in terms of climate emission reductions, but also the wider connection between budgets and the national performance framework. You've heard us make that point on many different occasions. In terms of the international comparison, Sally can say a bit more about this. The only thing I wouldn't want to leave the committee impression is that we think this is a simpler, straightforward thing to do. We recognise the complexity of doing that, and there will be good reasons why it's not just a case of, you know, we hadn't realised we needed to do that. We know that government are thinking carefully about this and are committed to doing it, also mirroring the judgments of the CCC that this was an essential next step. Sally.
Thank you. Yes, I think as the Auditor General's just said, it's an area that is complicated and the Scottish Government are grappling with it. And the work that they commissioned that we reference in Case Study 1 with the Scottish Parliament is is they were proactively trying to solve this problem, and it's not an area that other governments have solved. So we have meetings with the other UK audit agencies, and they're in a similar state. The NAO recently published a report on pathways to net zero, and it was issues round about assessing impact and monitoring arrangements that they were flagging, and not clear roles and responsibilities. So it's similar issues that are across the board, but we didn't audit those as part of this audit.
Yeah, I mean, I guess my horizons are a bit wider than the UK, and you know, what are the Scandinavian governments doing? What's happening in Germany? What's happening in some of the African states, for example? I presume that there's no point in every single government in every single country carrying out its own, from the start approach to this. There should be presumably shared understandings of how you can measure this and what the policy implications are and how you better make a measurement of the impact of decisions you're taking on your climate change targets, for example.
You're quite right, Convener, and you know, this would be an effective discussion which we expect will be taking place and has done so between the CCC and the Scottish Government, that they're drawing on experts, they're drawing on their understanding of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, and they've got that clear line of sight between what's good practice across the world and then factoring that into their own updated climate change plan. I think we're all expecting to see that, as Sally mentions, through the draft climate change plan at the end of this year and then the publication into 24.
Great, thank you. I'm going to move things along now and invite Craig Hoy to put some questions to you. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Bourne. Thank you for an informative report into an important issue that I think, as you say, cuts across government. I want to just look broadly at the risk management arrangements before drilling down perhaps on some of the progress or lack of progress in addressing those identified risks. But you just made reference to the CCC, and your report states that the Climate Change Committee has recently reported that there is a high risk that the Scottish Government's targets to reach its net zero emissions and adapt to climate change will not be achieved. And the report goes on to add that this high level of risk has been identified by the Scottish Government. For the benefit of the committee, could you perhaps elaborate on the steps that the Scottish Government is taking to address those identified risks?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Hoyle. I'll invite Rebecca to set that out in a bit of detail, maybe building on the point that she made a few minutes ago about the connection between adaptations and meeting climate change reductions. Rebecca.
Thanks, Auditor General. So, as you rightly identify, that the Scottish Government itself has identified that there's a high risk of it both not meeting its net zero targets and failing to adapt to the impacts of climate change. And both of these feature in its corporate risk register, and both of them score very highly in terms of likelihood and the severity of that risk if it were to occur. In terms of, you asked about what the government is doing to address these risks. So while there are a number of risk registers within at different levels within the Scottish Government that outline actions to address the various risks to not achieving the government's climate change goals. But what we found is that sometimes those actions are quite vague, and it's not actually that clear exactly what needs to happen or what the government intends to happen and what the expected impact of that action would be. So whilst there are a number of different actions against the variety of risks, and they cover things relating to staff and capacity, to governance, to developing plans and strategies, a whole range of things. But what we found was that the actions often are quite vague. So by that we mean that often they're not time bound. So it's not necessarily clear by which point the government anticipates those actions will be completed. They're not specific enough. So the language might be around developing a plan or enhancing engagement. It's not actually quite clear about, well, specifically what plan and what it will include, or engage with who and by when and to what purpose. So one of our main findings and one of our main recommendations related to it is that the government needs to be much clearer about exactly what which specific actions it intends to take to help reduce the risks that it's identified, and to be very specific about that, and then to actually put in place a systematic process to assess progress against those actions, because what we also found is that actually it's quite difficult to tell what impact those actions are having on reducing the risks that it's identified, because there's not a consistent process in place to allow them to monitor and track that and to evaluate the impact of those actions and to see what that means in terms of, is that helping to reduce the risk that they've identified or not.
Obviously, I think pages 19 to 21 of the report contains the exhibits which identify those risks. Exhibit 4, the Scottish Government's risk structure. Exhibit 5, the overview of the Scottish Government's climate change risk registers, to which you referred. And Exhibit 6, the Scottish Government's overview of the key risks to achieving climate change. Looking at those three exhibits in light of your answer there, is your primary concern around the adequacy and the scope of those risk registers and the measures taken by government, or is it the efficacy of the actions they're actually taking?
So probably both. I think the government have done a good job, particularly since the appointment of a Director General for Net Zero, for putting specific risk management arrangements in place for climate change. We've seen the establishment of a risk register specifically for that Director General area, and we've seen an increased focus on risk management specifically relating to climate change. But what we found is that there are still some gaps there in terms of the processes, and that means that it's not working as effectively as it could be or should be. And what that then means is that there's a risk that barriers to meeting the government's overall climate change aims and objectives could be getting missed when in executive level decision making. So if they're not featuring highly enough on risk registers, or if those risks aren't feeding through to the correct forums for discussion, then there is that risk that they might be getting missed or not given the focus or treated with the urgency that they require. So the government have put in place, as you can see from the exhibits, Mr. Hoy, a number of different risk registers. There are I think we would say appropriate risks identified within there, but it's about being more specific about those actions that need to be taken and fully evaluating the impact of those actions, and then if it's felt that they're not having the desired impact, then reviewing them again. We also make a recommendation around putting contingency plans in place for high risk areas. So if progress isn't being made, What's the plan B? If those actions that have been identified aren't doing what they need to do, what do we now need to consider doing going forward?
Just briefly, just to a layman looking at perhaps the structure and those three different exhibits, is there a risk that this is too cluttered, that you end up with too much, the mechanisms are too complicated for what it essentially should be quite an easy dashboard to read in terms of progress?
I think it's about how all those things are linked together. So it goes back to the point that the Auditor General and Sally made earlier about governance arrangements not being as joined up as they could be, and it not always being clear where the reporting lines are. The same applies in terms of the risk management process. So it's good to see a number of different risk registers at different levels of the Scottish Government, so that risks are being discussed by appropriate people and at appropriate levels. But it's about making sure that there are clear reporting lines between them, and also being very clear about where the escalation lines are. So if it's felt that risks need to be escalated, it's not always that clear how that'll happen and where it gets escalated up to.
Yeah, great. Mr. Ball, just in terms of the risk of not meeting the net zero targets has obviously been given a high risk score, meaning that it's very likely that those targets will not be achieved. And you also state that the impact of this would be severe. Could you just give us an impression of what severe would look like?
So I think it's hard for me to be definitive on that, and I would defer to the Climate Committee, Committee on Climate Change expertise. And so they set out that there's a high risk of not meeting climate emission reduction targets in their own report at the end of last year. To offer an audit perspective on that, Mr. Hoy, and again I'll draw on the Fiscal Commission's report, that without meeting some of the climate and budget challenges, alongside the wider prioritisation that will be required for the Scottish Budget in health and delivery of other priority areas, we'll likely see public services under real strain, and also kind of significant weather events that will, you know, change how we're leading our life and require further public expenditure to meet that. It's not to say that, so in all of this, you know, it's clear the government recognises that this is, you know, the challenges that we need to collectively meet over the course of the rest of this decade and beyond. What we need to see now is that through the climate change plan from next year, alongside really clear governance arrangements and effective risk management arrangements to support that decision making, is the next steps and recommendations that we make through our audit report today.
Obviously, the term just transition is now quite commonly used, if not commonly understood, and all called as adventure. What checks are in place to ensure that net zero targets are met in a way that is fair to all and that is truly a just transition? And for example, in relation to both the national economic interest and national security interest, last year I think the UK spent £40 billion buying oil and gas from Norway. So would it be right to have broader concerns, for example, that if we wind down Scotland's oil and gas sector, that there is obviously an impact that may not necessarily mean that that just transition is fair to all?
So the first thing I'd say is our audit didn't look at just transition arrangements into the future. And I think we recognise this is a really dynamic area of public spending and policy choices. And even that's, you know, reflected in some of the cabinet secretary structures that have evolved since we reported. Beyond that, I think it is like going to be about prioritisation, you know, of and probably difficult choices along the way to, you know, deliver a balanced budget and deliver the right outcomes that meet policy objectives for the Scottish Government, which includes just transition, alongside meeting climate change emission reduction targets and spending where we need to mitigate climate change through adaptations, alongside all of those other policy areas that will have an impact on climate change but are public spending in their own right. The task will be balancing all of these. And I think, as our report looks to set out, Mr. Hoy, governments will have a better chance of meeting all of these competing priorities by having strong risk management and governance arrangements in place. Yeah.
And just in terms of, obviously, you say the report doesn't look at just transition, but do you plan to, or is it intended to take more of an interest in the potential impact, both on individuals and organisations, if a just transition is not delivered on the timetable as planned by the Scottish Government, and then what impact might that have on its achievement of its net zero targets?
Yeah, I think, as you'll know, we keep our forward programme under regular review about the adjusting for a range of different factors, including change of government priorities and implications on service users. In terms of our next steps around climate change work, we're planning to do some further audit work around heat in homes, and we'll give further consideration to what just transition means, what public spending is planned for just transition alongside future carbon emission reduction and adaptation work. So we'll keep that under review.
And do you know why it took until December 2022 before a specific adaptation risk was added to the government's corporate risk register? Was there a particular reason for that?
I'll ask Rebecca to cover that. I think there's been a range of factors that will likely be relevant, not least the report from the CCC, which drew attention to this, and also government's attention and focus being on a range of different factors, including the pandemic and the after effects of that. But also, I think it is true to say that carbon emission reductions has been the priority. We've seen that through our work in terms of governance and risk registers. It's now there, but we expect additional focus on adaptations as we go forward. In terms of the timeline of why it took to December 22, Rebecca can say more if she knows.
Thank you. I think, as the Auditor General said, I think that's really reflective of the lack of focus on adaptation in general terms, compared to the focus on the 2045 net zero target. And going back to my earlier point, I think that's largely because some of these impacts won't be felt until the much longer term. The the risks around adaptation did appear in the Director General Net Zero Risk Register in March 2022, but as you point out, Mr Hoy, it did then take until December for that to filter through to the Corporate Risk Register, and it's really important that that risk is on there so that it's being considered at that very high executive level when decisions are being made.
And just in broad terms, I mean, most people and most organisations are obviously alert to the requirements to meet those net zero ambitions. But in terms of the public purse, do you think that the public sector, local government, right through perhaps, you know, the NHS estate, for example, are they prepared for the quite significant costs that are coming down the line to actually achieve their own targets that will be required to feed through to the national target?
So, first thing I would say, all public bodies are legally obliged to do so, to play their part to meet net zero ambitions. Much like the government, the Scottish Government itself, public bodies need to have, you know, clear plans in place that have public spending aligned to outcomes and aligned to carbon assessments. I think, like the conversation we've had already in some of Sally's responses, we're not seeing that clearly coming through yet. That will be a focus, you know, for our work, but really the onus on public bodies too, so they're absolutely clear about what their public spending, what their services are doing to deliver what's it primarily intended to do, but also that carbon impact is also set out. Some work to do.
Just finally, on a sort of technical point, your report suggests that focusing on the short-term impacts is not necessarily appropriate for assisting and assessing the impacts of climate change, because obviously the most severe impacts will be on the longer-term projections. Do you think the Scottish Government has indicated that it agrees with this point in your report? And if so, what steps is it taking to review how it calculates the risk score for climate change adaptation?
I'll ask Rebecca just to kind of say a bit more about that. In terms of the government's understanding and clarity of the report, as you would expect, Mr Hoy, we've gone through the factual accuracy check and the associated recommendations for that. But in terms of government's next step, they might be better placed to set out what their intent is. But Rebecca can offer more.
Thank you. So the Scottish Government recognise that point, and you'll see in our report that we've made a recommendation that in identifying actions to address risks in future, we would expect the Scottish Government to take those longer term impacts into consideration. I think in discussion with them, that was a point that they recognised, as the Auditor General said, in terms of the action that they're taking now to address that. I think probably the Scottish Government would be best placed to advise on that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Willie Coffey back in again, who's got a point to put. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's just on the comments made in paragraph 24 that Craig was leading on risk there. Could you explain to me the risk was established in 2019, and we would probably all put that in a corporate risk register if we were writing it ourselves, that we might not meet net zero targets. Are you saying that there's been no review of that from then till now, and therefore it remains as high as it was then? Given the comments I've just said that Chris Stark made, that we've largely decarbonised the power system, does that not tell us that the overall risk must surely have diminished? So that's how I see it, but I'd appreciate your view on that and what evidence you would lean on to say that it's very likely that we don't meet net zero targets. What's that based on, if we've got that evidence in front of us that there is a reduction in?
So I think there's a range of different sources that the Scottish Government is drawing on. Bear in mind, this is the Scottish Government's assessment, that there is a high risk, and also referencing the CCC's own report from December, which they've said that the Scottish Government didn't meet 7 out of its 11 targets, and that Scotland is leading on decarbonising, but or was leading the rest of the UK, but it's now of a similar level of progress. Scotland's also relying on transport emission reductions as being one of the primary drivers, but the report also references that Scotland isn't purchasing as many electric cars as other parts of the UK. So there's a range of different points in the CCC's report that point to progress being required to address that high risk. Ultimately, it's for the Scottish Government to decide itself what it considers to be high risk. Mr Coffey, and I think what we've set out in the report is that it's fine to say there's a high risk. What needs to be really clear is what actions you're going to take. And I think our assessment was that there was a lack of alignment between the actions that were planned to address the high risk and the risk itself, along with the other factors in terms of who owns that risk, what's that going to mean in terms of delivery dates, spending and so forth. But the overall assessment of high risk is probably one I would recognise, but in terms of the specifics around it would be for government to say.
OK. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Just continuing on the theme of risk management in a final series of questions that we wanted to put to you. One of the things that we read in the towards the end of the report was reference to an exercise which took place in the summer of 2022 inside the Net Zero Directorate, where they carried out what you describe as a risk housekeeping exercise. And the result of that was a conclusion that in the DG Net Zero Directorate, the maturity level on that housekeeping exercise was novice to organised. And my understanding is that what that means is that the Directorate had only just started to implement processes in line with Scottish Government guidelines. So it was a very early stage, a novice stage. Do you have a concern about that, given this is the Directorate which is supposed to be showing leadership and driving forward this agenda across the whole of government?
Yeah, I'll bring Rebecca in to say a bit more about some of our additional conclusions that we set out just slightly after the paragraph that you mentioned, Convener. The first thing I would recognise is this is a relatively new directorate within the Scottish Government, that it's an important step change that there is now a Director General to deliver upon net zero. And as I mentioned earlier on this morning, that staff will have migrated from other departments to form DG Net Zero. But in terms of the maturity of risk management arrangements, that they were still novice in the summer of 2022 shows that there's quite a long way to go on such an important policy priority area. And that needs to happen quickly in terms of having robust, effective risk management arrangements to support the delivery of such an important policy objective. Work to do, and I think as we set out further on in the report, our own assessment of some of the risk management arrangements also identified a number of areas for improvement that Rebecca can touch on.
Thank you, Auditor General. Just on the, before I come on to more detail of what we found in our report, on the risk maturity assessment of novice organised, just for information, the committee might find it helpful. So there's a scale of 7 and the novice organised is a third from the bottom. So as you recognise, Convener, still some way to go there. I think we would hope that the recommendations that came out of that review alongside our own recommendations will help support the Scottish Government in strengthening its risk management arrangements further. I think some of the we've touched on some of the gaps and weaknesses that we identified in our report already. I think for us, the key things are about having robust processes in place and evidence-based processes in place to allow the government to identify risks to not meeting its climate change goals, and then putting very specific actions in place to address those risks, and then having a systematic process to assess progress against those actions. And alongside that, just being very clear about who owns the risk, how risks are escalated, and making sure that contingency plans are in place, as I said earlier, in case the actions are not having the impact that they were anticipated in having.
But aren't some of these things pretty basic requirements? And I'll look to you, Auditor General. I mean, it seems to me that the report points out that details of planned actions are vague, that they do not include completion dates, and neither is there any estimate of expected impacts. I mean, that is pretty rudimentary, isn't it, if you're carrying out a programme of work which was designed to bring about transformative change?
We'd agree, Convener. Some of these things are really fundamental tenets of risk management arrangements, and also really reflected our ambition with today's report to set these out to elicit the kind of change that absolutely has to happen to support the effective delivery, the Scottish Government's leadership role in delivering upon climate change ambitions for the changes that we'll all need to make across public bodies and us as individuals and indeed private sector too. Having just clear, consistent risk management arrangements is one of those fundamental building blocks. So just to repeat, yes, there's work to do to get that all done effectively.
But, and the other area, just for completeness, but the other area that you mentioned in the report is that the GCE Programme Board does not have risk management arrangements in place itself, despite a recommendation from a 2019 internal review that that ought to be a priority. So in 2019, this was something identified as a priority, and here we are in 2023, and it's still not in place.
Yeah, again, Rebecca can say more about kind of what our understanding is of expected progress arrangements. Inevitably, there's a link between governance arrangements and risk management. I think we've seen throughout the report about the, a complex area with a lot of governance happening around it in different places. The clarity around risk ownership, escalation arrangements through to corporate board, and so on. So I think we are seeing some progress, convener. I would say, I think particularly the Scottish Government's executive team is now very clear through its performance reporting, the different settings that it operates in, and that ownership of risk is there and under the direction of DG Net Zero. But it's still quite early days. And having, I think, especially when we consider the time frame from the climate emergency being declared in 2019 through to some of those works not happening over a three-year period. Pandemic aside, we'd have expected to see stronger arrangements in place. Rebecca can say a bit more if she wishes about the GCE Programme Board.
I think, as the Auditor General said, we were surprised that the GCE Programme Board didn't have its own risk register in place, given its remit to provide oversight and assurance of climate change at a corporate level. And you'll see from our report that we've recommended that they do put one in place and make sure that has clear reporting lines to some of the wider climate change governance arrangements. Why that wasn't put in place, we don't entirely know. We do know that obviously there were changes between 2019 and now, one of the most substantial being the appointment of the DG Net Zero towards the end of 2021, and that then saw them progress made in putting specific risk management arrangements in place for climate change. But why nothing has happened over that period, we don't know. And obviously we would like to see our recommendation implemented as soon as possible.
OK, well, thank you. Well, obviously one of the considerations the committee will have to make is whether it would be useful for us to indeed invite officials from the DG Net Zero to give evidence to us, and perhaps if we were to decide to do that, we could put some of the questions which have arisen this morning from our session with you to them directly. For the meantime, can I thank very much indeed, Auditor General, you for the evidence that you've led this morning, but also especially to Rebecca Seidel and Sally Thompson as well for the very useful evidence that you have also contributed. I should have mentioned at the start that Colin Beattie had submitted his apologies for today's meeting. So for the record, I just wanted to have that recorded. But I'm now going to close the public part of this morning's committee session and move us into private matters.